Hi, my name is Emily.
Hi, my name's Ashna,
And this is our
and
theater vlog.
Theater 101, class, it's from 4 to 5:20.
Yes. With Professor Baldwin.
Philip Baldwin.
Philip Baldwin, thank you so much for letting us do this vlog. This was so much easier.
Because, like, you already know when we're sending this in.
Sorry. Okay, so
Go
I
ahead.
hope you enjoy our 40 topics. We will put a like a description in the box below.
I just
YouTube
wanted
is
to
okay.
do that.
We'll put like, a little overview of our topics in the description box. And yeah, we hope you enjoy.
Well, sorry, we might be rambling in the
Oh
videos, but
yeah.
yeah, I think it was definitely better than having to write them. Like, I feel like we got more out of this, and it was definitely more fun than writing vlogs.
Yeah.
So, think
We
of
were
that
able
for.
to like bounce ideas off of each other. It was definitely cool.
It was that whole, like, talking and, like, bouncing ideas, like interaction you want us to do in class. And look,
Yeah,
that's
look at
what
us.
we learned.
Yeah. Okay.
Joy.
Yeah, so, okay, cool.
Okay, so I think we should first talk about VR World because that was a whole experience on its own for our trip to the city. First of all, walking into VR World, the first thing you saw was all of the games that they had set up. Well, first of all, there was a lot of kids there too.
True. I thought we saw a huge like group of boys come in, but yeah. That's because it seemed cool.
It was a lot of interactive stuff. I mean, because that's what VR is, but they had a area where you could put goggles on to make it look like you were walking like across like skyscrapers on like a what's it
A plank.
called? A plank.
But I think one of the cool things, I liked the plank one. And then I liked the one that Jack and O'Neill were trying to do,
Oh, it so
the
it looked
flying
like
kind
they
of
were like
thing.
skydiving or it
Yeah,
was like
some
paragliding.
kind of flying type
But
thing.
it was like a whole machine, like machine almost. Like you had to like lay down on it, like on your stomach, and like hold it like this, and like your feet were out being held,
And
and
like
you.
a lot of core strength for that, you know.
That's what we were told, so we didn't
Yeah.
do it. But
Overall, it seemed like a really cool area, I think. That's a big point. But I wish we had more time to play around with it, I will say that.
yeah, what I did like. Was ups in the upstairs was it's like kind of like a relaxing room instead of doing games or like interactive stuff. It was basically you sat down in the chair and then you got a look at you got to pick from a music portfolio like documentaries, what
Think
else?
like an art something.
Arts, drama.
Yeah.
There was like adventure stuff, so it's like you're basically immersed in that through VR. And it wasn't like you had to do anything. It was just like you were there looking at everything or like being told what it was.
And so I think that's what makes like VR really cool. It lets you be interactive and just focus in on like this one thing you're doing without like other distractions, because like your eyes are like occupied, your ears are occupied, so like you get to like focus in. I think that's really cool, like with VR, because I wouldn't be able to watch a music video and like just the music video,
And
like it's
block out
yeah.
everything else going around you.
Yeah.
Exactly. So. It puts you more in the experience than it would just watching a video on like your computer.
So I think that's really cool.
What I thought was really cool was like it took like games that you play on your phone or like on the Wii and like made it into VR. So like Fruit Ninja. Did you really think that like you'd be able to like
I didn't see that.
that was in the corner,
What?
but it's like so you had your goggles on and then just like the game of Fruit Ninja, like fruit were coming up in the air and then you were holding your sword and then you'd have to try and cut them. So like
Oh.
imagine being basically the ninja in the
In the
game
game.
instead of like you know just swiping your finger on a phone. Like so much more
You're like actually
interactive.
in it, as if you're actually fighting.
And then there was like the
I
one with
saw
the
that with
fighters.
boxing or
Yeah.
something like that. Yeah, that was cool. And so like I think talking about VR, like with that whole place, like even as she was explaining and Professor Baldwin was
Melissa?
explaining, yeah, as Melissa was explaining, like you can use the VR for so much more than just that stuff. And so I think that's pretty cool about VR, like when you're talking about it in like the science aspect, like that could come in very handy. Like, oh, that they had that cube, the cube,
Oh,
where you can see the heart and the
this was
skull.
less VR, and it was more almost like 360, almost holographic, not holographic, but
I don't know,
like,
but like whatever
the way
it
popped out at you.
Yeah.
It's basically just like a foam cube, but I think it has like
some
metal
sort of
or like
thing.
Sensor like coating stuff on it, so that when you put it like in front of your camera, oh, it was like an iPad camera, and you like put it in front. We have videos and photos.
Yes.
You could pick like a heart
or a skull,
and then like it shows you like the entire anatomy of it. Like you can turn the cube, and it's like turning the heart. Like you have the heart in your hand. It labeled everything too for you, so it's like it's a good learning tool for people.
Yeah, so I feel I don't know if that's exactly VR, but I think that and just like the what's the thing called,
the headsets.
Yeah, the headsets and everything. Like I feel like it could be used as more than just like being able to enjoy some type of entertainment, but like also educational aspects, as they were explaining. And that's pretty cool.
I liked the presentation that Bigmo did.
With the protein folding.
Mm-hmm. Because, like, that really puts into perspective, like, VR doesn't have to just be, like, interactive, fun stuff. Like, there's, like, serious stuff that you can, like, make an impact on about the whole cancer and protein folding.
Yeah. It was a little confusing what they were saying because we're not, like, computer
as advanced either.
Yeah, like we don't know about computer stuff and everything, but the way they were explaining it, it seemed as if the VR could really help in learning about specific proteins, because like, you can't physically see a protein because
mm-hmm.
it's so small inside your body, but like it's like a good learning tool. So
what I got out of that also was I thought it'd be cool, like in the future, like what about learning about like protein synthesis, like you'd be able to do that through VR, and like you could see like the proteins like transcribing and like going through the whole system, or like learning a lot about like science too in like a VR environment would be easier, like learning about like photosynthesis or like the Krebs cycle. That's like stuff like you have to like visually see, but you have to like
right now we only have the ability
have written
to
stuff.
Know about like
yeah.
see like a diagram or something,
so we don't know like how it's actually moving or how it's interacting with like other cells, but like through VR it could be almost like a lifelike situation having
mm-hmm.
that like model. Or it's like with the CRISPR technology, like you could learn how to like through that protein base, like say you have your VR on, like you can like say be the CRISPR like machine that takes out like those certain genes, so you understand like what that machine is, like not the machine, but it's whatever it is, the agents that are taking out the specific like codes.
I think it could definitely like lead to like perfecting processes like that, so that you can even
Melissa said like it'd be more like humane too, so like surgical procedures, that's definitely
yes.
like a new thing. Like there's a lot of people, like, you know, there's controversy over whether or not people should be using cadavers or like animals, so being able to use like VR and like basically pretend that you are cutting open someone and like performing a surgery would be easier than having to go through the whole process of the whole
cutting open an actual like body.
Like it's understandable that like the experience, you need real life experience in order to fully understand what's going on,
mm-hmm.
but it's a good step in like starting to learn the basics.
Yeah, like
everything.
Even from the beginning, like when you start med school or whatever, like being able to do it virtually, and then because by the time you get to the actual cadaver,
mm-hmm.
like you can,
you at least know background knowledge of like, oh, what's gonna happen if I do this, or like
mm-hmm.
if you mess up, or like how do you know how to fix it, blah blah blah.
Yeah, but I think that's a lot to learn from like VR world. That was
mm-hmm.
really, that was a cool experience. I wish we had more time, because like we got there really early and started our hour and we lost our hour.
So. We played the game with the fox,
mm-hmm.
and what I got out of that was, like, sitting there with the VR goggles on, I felt almost like my head was wobbling the entire time, almost dizzy. Like, being in that environment is so different from, like, just watching it on a screen, so it's different, like, the perception of it's different. So, like, Melissa was saying, how your eyes are, like, perceived. They're, like, tricked, basically, into thinking that you're, like,
actually
doing that worm. Mm-hmm. Is it like she said with the tightrope or whatever?
Yeah, like you actually think that you're that high up in the air or like in that game.
It's like your brain doesn't process it, and so like you're just tricked into thinking. Like your mind is tricked into thinking
that you're actually there,
even though you know you're not there. But like,
yeah, like I could be. I was talking to her, but like still, she felt like she was very immersed in the game.
And then they talk about like people like being afraid of heights. Like even then, like knowing that they're not even like they're still on the ground, they wouldn't want to do something like this because like that's how like into it it gets and how much of an experience you get out of doing it.
Yeah, like when we saw, his name's David, when David was on the thing, like, in the beginning, he was fine. Like, I think he knew he was going to be walking across that plank, because when you walk up to the game, you see the plank there. But then, like, a few seconds in, like, he actually started to, like, you know, like,
wobble
like, a little.
His mind definitely was, like, playing games on him by then. Like, at first, like, he definitely, like, knew it, but after, it was, like, still a little trippy.
Yeah, but I think that's all. This next topic is about VR and gaming, to be specific.
So, as much as we discussed how, like, the gaming was fun and all that, there is the downside of it, because, like, you're so immersed into it and you do get that full experience, like, you are actually in the gaming environment.
Like, when Professor Ball, like, for that, like, when you actually think you're immersed in it, it's like when Professor Ball was talking about the shooting games and, like, the more violent games, like, if you're fully immersed into a game like that and you think you're actually in it, then, like, when you come out of the VR, like, you're still probably going to be in that mindset. Like,
so, like, people right now, like, just with regular video games kind of feel like, oh, I can, like, kill this many people in my game, like, I know how to use these kind of guns or these weapons, like, I can do it out in the real world now, like, it's fine to do that, but then, like, putting it in VR basically enhances those threats.
Yeah. Like, I can actually say, I just thought of it, with Fortnite, oh, it's so bad. With Fortnite, Alex will literally be like, I can imagine building something over there. And, like, when he was trying to teach me about the thing, he's like, oh, like, this gun, like, just rapidly shoots, and, like, this, it's not.
So like, these games teach you so much. And then.
So just imagine, like, fully being immersed into it. Like, on a daily basis, like, a lot of people play their video games on a daily basis.
They learn more about it. People even, like, get so into it, they do, like, they'll do research on the games, too, or, like, on the weapons, or, like, ooh, what should I use, or stuff like that. And then, so, once you give them that knowledge, it's kind of a free-for-all after that.
Like, what is that, violent game? Was that GTA or something?
Grand Theft Auto. Yeah. There's like, so many other ones. Call of Duty.
You will think you have the ability to, like, force someone out of their car, take their car and speed down the street. Like, I feel like that's what could happen with having video games in VR.
And then, like, the VR gives you, like, more confidence, too, because you actually feel like you're in that game.
Like, you've done it before.
Yeah.
Obviously. You know?
But yeah, all in all, I don't think it's the best thing for, like, violence video games. I feel like VR could be used for so much more positive things. And, like, yes, gaming is always, like, a nice relief, but it's not something that it should be, like, thought of as lightly.
Especially when people want to blame a lot of things on these video games, too. Like, if you're going to blame video games for giving this person a certain mindset, and, like, oh, like, that's why they have turned out the way they have, like, don't let that be an opportunity then. Like, I don't think that should be, like, video games and VR should be an opportunity. That's just terrifying.
Like, I get, like, what is it, like, Minecraft? That's more like a building game. So that's, like, teaching you, like, how, like, you'd want to structure a world or, like, how to build something. But violent video games where it's just all about killing, stealing, trying to compete with people to be on top, and if that means irrational or, like, inhumane, that's the way to do it, like, that's how you're gonna win, then that's probably not something we should be teaching or, like, exposing to more people in a more real-life situation.
Especially since, like, this VR, it's not gonna be, like, around our time. Well, this is our time, but, like, I feel like we're more not as susceptible to, like, being influenced as, like, little kids are, so imagine little kids from the time that they're playing video games are immersed that fully into, like, violent games like that. I mean, imagine it was like if it was like a child game. Like, oh yeah, that's fine. You know, you're playing with like Mickey Mouse, whatever. Is there a game like that? I don't know. That would be cute, but
learning
I don't know
how
about
to like do your ABCs. Or, yeah. Like, educational purposes, it's
great.
Totally
great.
Understandable, but then it draws like a fine line.
Just take your hair out.
What we were talking about was the pros of having VR and how it enhances your experience and being able to put yourself into certain situations or places. So that is why we want to talk about the project that just, not just came up, but like the project that your class did or like a few people did on being able to like pick a place on like Google Maps and just be able to transport themselves there basically.
Do the VR, like being able to like from the comfort of your own home, act as if you're in that place, like there with the people and stuff like that. And was that project specifically for
Syria? I don't think it was specifically for Syria, but like one of the main point like hot points of that project was you were able to like go to Syria or Aleppo and like see and like
see what's going on.
Basically almost experience it too.
Because like right now all we have to base our mindsets on is like the media, and the media is not reliable sometimes, and like it can twist some things. But if you're given the opportunity to go like directly into the country and see what's going on, I feel like that could be pretty eye opening for people.
Like unless you're someone that travels a lot, you're not gonna like fully understand what another country is going through unless you're there in that moment. And like VR lets you like do that in the sense like you get to see like how these people are living their lives and like what's really going on.
Because we definitely take our lives for granted here. Mm-hmm. Like you don't see bombs flying through the air every 5 seconds. Not every 5 seconds, but you know. Like you don't see that here. But there in countries like that,
it's basically like a big cover, like a blanket over our country, like not seeing it, but with like the VR goggles it's like opening up your eyes and like you notice like what's actually going on in the world.
Yeah. You'd be able to experience it firsthand, and like some people need that eye opener and you know, in this country they need that. You can also use the VR for travel.
Mm-hmm. Like if you aren't a big traveler but you've always wanted to, or maybe like financially not stable, maybe like you physically can't, or like mentally you just don't have that capacity to be able to do that.
Yeah, like some people are afraid of planes.
Some people are afraid of transportation. Maybe they're just not they're just not comfortable like being able to like go into another country like maybe mm-hmm. without enough experience, or like they just don't feel like they'd be able to do it by themselves, something like that.
And like you said, like financially, it's not cheap to travel, obviously.
Yeah.
So like with the VR, if you were able to go and experience like big places, like big points and like cities, and not even just big points, but like, you know, like little towns,
take
stuff
like
that.
The VR goggles and you'd be able to see what the Eiffel Tower looked like.
Yeah.
Or like the Colosseums in Rome, or maybe even just like the beach in California, if that's, like, something that you don't get to experience. But,
like, maybe there, even if, like, there are people that, like, really like going to this one place all the time, but, like, mm-hmm. for 1 year they couldn't go. Like Disney.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Disney, you know? I've been once, and I want to go again. But, you know, I can't. But if with the VR goggles, I could.
Mm-hmm. Or say, like, basing it off of that, like, say, like, it's come to a point, like, where you're just physically not fit enough to travel, like maybe you have like certain conditions, or like maybe you're just too old, or I don't know, mm-hmm. like you don't have the time to do it. VR gives you that opportunity. You can just sit down and like almost pretend like you're in that place. Like maybe it's like a special place to like you and your family, and you just want to revisit that moment one more time, and that's like a good way to do it. Okay, so next, after our
we talked about VR,
and now we think it'd be a good time to talk about artificial intelligence, because that's something that's really coming up, and it's like a new, not new, but it's like a more important thing in
it's
technology.
Becoming more popular.
Like, people are utilizing it more now, and like understanding like the benefits and downsides to having artificial intelligence and our lifestyles.
So, like, the example that comes to my mind I think of AI, it took me a few seconds, you know, is like, it's like Alexa and Google Home and Siri and stuff like that. So that's definitely useful. I feel like that, like advancing in that terms is definitely useful because it makes it, you don't have to do something yourself.
It's like,
if I want to.
Hands-free, like instant kind of like buying a product. Like Alexa, make sure to order tissues or like.
Yeah, whatever. Like you don't have to physically set a reminder or like play that song or anything like that. Like you can, it's like a personal servant type thing.
Basically, you know? Like you have your own assistant there. Like all you have to do is like.
Well, isn't command isn't them. One of them literally called Google Assistant?
I think so.
Something like that. Yeah. Like.
I mean, at least it was like a little more humane. They just gave like Alexa like a name, for, like Amazon gave it like Alexa instead of like someone like you.
It just makes it more interesting. Yeah, the Google ones are just like Google Home.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but like still, you can talk to it like another human being, and ask them to like get you something or like remind you to do something, set like a timer or something like that. I think that's definitely a benefit of AI.
Some weird stuff that has gone on though is like the fact that like they've had Google and Alexa being able to like talk to each other, like
that's just freaking.
Because AI, like they make their own language and that like they can communicate with, but we don't really understand it. Or like Facebook and like some other thing it was. I think it might have been Alexa. I don't really know. But either way, it's like after there's like a certain point like where we don't have control over them anymore because they're able to like
think on their own,
yeah,
kind
exactly.
of.
Yeah.
That's a little freaky. Like, I saw, I think it was on Twitter, I saw Alexa and Google Home were having a conversation. Like, imagine just being in your house and hearing a conversation suddenly go on.
Like
that would
you
freak
may not
me out.
Know, like, what it is, or, like, what if it's, like, someone hacking into your system, or just the computer's going haywire. Like, I don't think they could do physical harm, but it's definitely something, like, if Alexa's hooked up to your bank accounts, your home security, like, basically everything in your life, and you give her access to it, it's like, you, like, basically are giving someone else control of your entire life. So it's like, what if, like, it gets hacked, or what if it malfunctions?
Yeah,
like, anything could go wrong. But I don't think it's gonna be, like, something physical where they, like, grow some legs and start like attacking you or something like
that. Yeah, but like
I think that's when like movies start to get a little fuzzy there and they're like, oh yeah, no, AI, it's gonna start doing that.
But like definitely when everything is linked to these types of AI and stuff like that, like imagine the thing just unarms your house, like your the security system, or like
if it's like this is in the movies again, but like those systems where everything just goes under lockdown because the AI like malfunctions and is like basically taking over.
Yeah.
Like in the movie that we watched, I don't even remember that name. Ex Machina. It was like she basically like the robot, the AI like locked down everything and like trapped him and like she began to like take control. It's like something like that could happen, but like maybe not to that extent. More, it's like giving the links of everything in your life, like a bank account and all that.
It's definitely still scary, though, I think.
Very.
So I think it's important that if it does advance on, like, we learn how to control these types of things, because
maybe, like, understanding what, like, language they're transmitting to each other, like,
because the thing is,
more
we are
security
creating
options.
It.
Yeah.
The thing, like, we are creating it. It's just a little
so
scary.
So how is it advancing over us, is
yeah,
the thing.
That's a little scary.
One of the other things about AI, like in the movie Her, I think that's what it's called. It's Her. It's a guy. It's like this geek that basically falls in love with his AI system, and that's kind of like just showing like how insociable people can be. Like, yeah, like you can talk to like Alexa or Siri and like get hints or even just have a conversation with them, but then
to actually fall in love.
Fall in love to that extent. That's like gone a little overboard.
That could be a little unhealthy.
Very.
Definitely.
What was cool was how in class that we can like type up a whole like script and have Alexa like repeat it, like not repeat it, but
answer back.
Yeah, give her feedback almost like it's not as emotional, but it's still like a type of feedback.
It's a type of conversation you can have.
Mm-hmm.
That was cool. It was like the suicide note.
The suicide note and the love letters.
Dear child. Yeah. Like that. That does seem pretty cool. I feel like any type of interaction could help in any type of situation. Yes, like emotion, I definitely feel like I need the emotion, but like there could be people out there that just need a person to talk to. So even if you're talking to a computer, I
mean, like even like people just need advice, and like computers can give advice, like they know facts, they know like the kind of stuff, but you're not gonna get that empathy from them or like any emotion that's gonna come out from them. You're just gonna get a monotone like response.
But at the same time, if we do advance with AI, like maybe you can like add that like empathy in there.
The kind of like pitch and the tone is what gives off the empathy. But like when we put the script in to Alexa, there was like a little pause in between, but like she was still able to give like at least somewhat coherent answers to like what professor was talking about. So like if we can do that now and we're college students, like just imagine like a few next years, now when we like are more in depth into like technology and like what we can do with that.
And when like people have a better understanding of it. Like it
she can give like constant responses like right after you ask it, like I would if I like ask someone a question.
Yeah. Like go places.
AI.
Segment. We're gonna be talking about 360, like versus VR kind of. And like what exactly 360 is, stuff like that.
Maybe like a little back history of what we were thinking about 360 was, so you know that 360 is a whole overview of like everything going around.
You can see everything.
But like the first thing that came before that was like panoramas, and that's basically almost everything. Like that's like what, like 180? No, a little bit more than that.
I feel like it could be like, yeah, like you'd be able to get a greater view.
If you have your box, it's three of the corners of the box, and it's just you that you're not getting in the back. So like panoramas are like a step into it.
Actually, honestly, I feel like you can take a panorama all around you, but it's just like in a vertical, like a horizontal picture.
So that's like a still frame of it, but still. So we think that's like maybe like the step into 360, and then like we came into 360 cameras, which allowed us to like have that effect of like being that person in the situation, like of a video, like saying like this is what Emily sees, like even like stuff she doesn't see, like behind her, like around the sides too.
And so I think it's pretty cool, like she was saying, like thinking before, that now anybody can have access to taking videos in 360. Like just on Facebook they have that. Like when I scroll past a video, sometimes, like, I'll see that it's a 360 thing. I saw this one video of puppies. It was just a 360 video of puppies. It was great. And so you can, like, just scroll, like, you know, move the thing or, like, move your... I think you can actually move
your
phone.
You can move your phone, so it's, like, your camera's almost
like you're turning.
And you turn, and it's, like, the image turns with you. So
yeah.
It's...
But sometimes when I'm just sitting there, like, I feel like you can just, like, turn it also with your finger. But whatever it is, like, you actually have, like, the ability to be able to see it. And so I think that's pretty cool. Definitely that, like, it's more accessible to the average person nowadays.
But then, like, if you think about it, like, when we go into, like, 360 and VR, it's, like, 360, that's something, like, you'll look at and maybe, like, be interested in for, like, 10 seconds at most. Be like, oh, wow, that was cool. And then just, like, go on to, scroll down to the next thing. But then, because, like, it is an experience. Like, you get to experience that. But, again, that experience is so short. And it's, like, it's not going to, like, you're not going to dive right into it.
Yeah, it's not like you're going to be, like, you have to be stuck there or anything like that. Like, you're not going to be, like, oh, I want to sit here for the next 2 hours doing this. Like, it's not that, like...
immersive.
Yeah.
But then it's, like, VR, like, think about it. You have, like, those goggles. Like, you don't see anything else going around you. It's just what that screen is projecting. So it's, like, it's more interactive. Like, you feel like you're actually in that experience rather than just seeing the experience.
And, like, I feel like when we mentioned, like, before with the VR thing, like, the VR actually plays a trick on your mind, so you think you're actually in it. Like, the 360 video doesn't exactly do that. Like, you know that you're just looking at the video, but the VR, like, you feel like you're actually in it, so it's more of, like, interactive, like you were saying, than just experiencing, like, and Professor Robin was saying how, like, 360 is more like, you know, if you go to a coliseum, and like you take the 360 video.
Like, cool, like the person like taking the video is like, oh my god, this is amazing. But then people are like, they know
when I'm, they're watching,
like, I'm sitting on my couch, I'm like, wow, that's cool, like he sees the Coliseum. But then
if you were in a VR at that Coliseum, like you would actually like be like, wow,
you'd like, feel like you're there.
Yeah,
like that experience, like again, like being tricked into, like your brain's gonna be tricked
into that you're actually there. Yeah, so I think that's definitely like what makes VR cooler than 360, mm-hmm. I guess. Mm.
360 is, like, I think more beneficial when it's, like, still life. Like, not experiences, but more, like, maybe for art or, like, mm-hmm. projecting just, like, one message. Like, when you're trying to show, like, a place or, like, something going on, it's, like, VR is something more interactive that you'd want to be more interested in.
I think also like maybe like levels of excitement, like mm-hmm. you know, 360, like you're saying, it's more like a, I feel like it's more like a calm, like, oh yeah, like just look around type of thing. But VR could be like, oh my god, like you're gonna splash into that water,
yeah,
like, jump into this thing. Like, I feel like it's definitely like more exciting
also. So it's like picking the levels of excitement and interactivity you want.
So our next topic is about how everything's becoming more technology based and whether we think it's good or bad.
We're basically in a tech generation. Like right now, this is probably like, I wouldn't say the peak, but it's definitely like the most advanced and like it basically like exponential growth right there. Like we started off like real small with our technology, but like it just skyrocketed in the past like several years, because like if you think about it, like what? It was not long ago before, like, computers were even big. Like, I remember, like, when we were younger, it was, like, typewriters, floppy disks, and all that kind of stuff. It wasn't, like...
Floppy disk.
Yeah, I know. Floppy... Like, we still remember that. Yeah. So, like, if you think about it, it really wasn't that long ago. Like, the amount of advancements we've made just in these, like, past, like, 10, 15 years is really big. So, oh my god, Isabel.
And, like, when you say it's, like, the highest it's ever been... Like, yeah, I definitely agree with that, because I have little cousins, little friends that know how to use technology just as much as I do.
It's crazy how little kids pick up on it so quickly now.
Yeah.
Like, I get that, like, we know so much more than our parents do now about, like, technology, but...
It's crazy that a three-year-old knows how to play with Snapchat.
Yeah, they know, like, what the iPhone is. They know how to
unlock your phone.
They know, like, what games to go to, like...
Exactly what the app looks like.
So it's like,
is that a good thing?
I think, honestly, it's like the way you grow up. So like, older generations think that we're just so, like,
what's the word? Stuck in our phones.
Stuck on our phones, or like we're just too technology based. But the thing is, like, that is what we grew up with. Like, that is what we know. This is like how, like, what's been going on around us. Like, new technology everywhere. So like, we're the ones that need to know how to use them, how, like, it's growing, I guess, too, but...
But part of me just, like, worries, like, I don't want to sound like an old person, but, like, just worries a little bit for, like, the younger generation that's, like, always stuck in, like, their phones or, like, a game or an mm-hmm. iPad. Like, I know, like, there's, like, family friends who have little children. Like, these little children are, like, rewarded with their iPads. Or, like, or rewarded like,
you
with
you see younger kids with, like, iPads, like, iPods, seen, like, phones, elementary computers, school exactly.
Like, better phones than I have. Like,
it's, like, they're just, like, that's the way parents are, like, parenting now these days. It's like,
and I don't know how I feel about that.
Yeah, but I feel like our time period that we grew up in was definitely different, because it's, like, you have, like, our parents who really didn't even, like, grow up with any of this kind of stuff, like, they probably didn't have a cell phone until, like, probably their 20s, 30s, like, if anything. Computers weren't that big. Like, it was all in the books, like, going to the library. Like, I know that's going to sound
the library.
Like, going to the library where there's books. Yeah, we know what that's about. But the thing is, like, we were able to, like, immerse ourselves in both cultures. Like, we were growing up in the time that technology was really, like, evolving. Coming out and evolving. So, we kind of get
that's why
both sides of it. Like, we know, like... Like, we feel bad for, like, we understand, like, the adults, like, what they're saying, but we also understand, like, why we're standing up for kids, too.
But, like, part of me just wants, like, it to stay in our middle ground mm-hmm. thing, because I feel like kids in our generation know how to go. Okay, I'm not a nature person, but I still know how to go outside and enjoy like fresh air. Mm-hmm. But like, I feel like little kids, they're just gonna be stuck in their game and like, and stuff like that, and that's a little scary
like,
for me.
The more and more technology that comes out, it's gonna be like, oh no, I can have this interactive game where it's like, I'm going outside, yeah. I'm going camping, but that's like, that's not the same it's as actually same. Being able to like, step outside,
make and, like, friends, go outside,
feel the sun, yeah. like the fresh air, and like hear everything. It's like a whole different experience. So,
yeah. And like if everyone's just like in this technology, like in their video games, like oh my friend on this game, like no, mm-hmm. how about your friend outside? Like I feel like that's a little scary for me, but I definitely do think that having the technology is good though. Like
then there's like that fine line between like is technology like. Taking away our social ability, or is it like giving us more? Because if you think about it, like I do think that technology is giving us more of a social like outlet, because there's people who are just not like able to like communicate in person with other people. Maybe they have that anxiety, or they're just like not socially like
inclined
or like stable to do that. So it's like social media, or like being able to like talk on the internet, or like just like going on the internet and looking stuff up, that like gives them an outlet instead of having to like do this one-on-one person like conversation, even though like people think like, oh, if you can't do that, you're just really not succeeding in life. But then on the other hand, it's like people are just gonna be stuck on their computers,
yeah, like,
all the time.
Well, they use it as an excuse,